we don't have much time and we have to finish before everybody wants to go for lunch, I would introduce the next pair of speakers. They are a team, actually. I will introduce both of them together. So they are Bharat and Gurpreet. I'll introduce Bharat first. Bharat is an engineer, and like all engineers, he's interested in everything else but other than engineering. He also has a management degree. He's worked in automotive technology, IT services, and automotive aftermarket, but he's more interested in travel, history, photography, literature, and politics. He travels across the state of Tamil Nadu to capture the ancient living temples of the state. He and Gurpreet are working on a coffee table book on the Pallava and Chalukya temples, and he's going to talk to us about South Indian temple architecture today. He lives in Chennai. He's on Twitter. He's usually famous as @Breku. If you are on Twitter, please follow him. Now I come to Gurpreet. He's co-author of this coffee table book on Chalukya and Pallava architecture. Gurpreet is a finance professional holding, again, an engineering degree and master's of finance. But again, your education has got nothing, doesn't have to do anything with your passion. So she is interested in travel, history, literature, and she loves exploring various themes relating to Indian culture and its origins. She lives in Mumbai with her family, and she's on Twitter as Guri Chopra. And she's, as I said, she's a co-author with Bharat of a coffee table book on Chalukya and Pallava architecture. And Bharat and Gurpreet are going to talk to us about the Dravida style of temples. As sir has already explained, there are two main styles. One is roughly known as North Indian style, which is Nagara, and one is the South Indian style, which is known as the Dravida style. There is a separate subtype, which is Kalinga architecture, which our next speaker is going to talk to about. But I now leave the stage open for Bharat and Gurpreet to talk about the Dravida style of architecture. Thank you.
Thanks, Shefali ji. I hope everybody can see the screen. I'm going to keep the video off. I don't want bandwidth issues going forward. First of all, Guri, on behalf of Guri and myself, I thank the Academy for giving this opportunity to two amateurs. The topic is quite vast. We've tried to cover as many aspects of it as possible in these 40, 45 minutes. In the first 20 minutes, I'll run through some theory. Dr. Deglurkar has already covered a lot of it, so I will just touch upon this and get into the basic details of Dravida style. Then I will take you through a visual journey of Pallava temples. And in the next 20 odd minutes, Guri will take you through Chalukya temples, covering a lot more elements. As Shefali ji said, we've jointly co-authored a coffee table book under the guidance of Dimple ji and Hari Kiran ji, and we hope it'll hit the stand sometime soon. The book will have way more details than what we are presenting today. I will start with what Lord Krishna said in the Bhagavatam about the punya of building a temple. Now, while not every ruler was a Sri Vaishnava, I think every ruler was fully cognizant of what he would attain by building a temple. So much so that one rarely comes across huge palaces or grandiose residences of illustrious kings, but one definitely comes across the grand temples built by their rulers. Building temples, as Dr. Deglurkar already said, involved very clearly defined principles. And with massive rise of temple construction sometime around the 4th-5th century, several texts have been written to ensure that the construction of a temple met its divine purpose. Mayamata, which he also mentioned in the text that he read out, Manasara, Shilpasara, etc., elaborate all aspects of the rituals, the architecture, the deity of the temple, and they're also considered standard texts of Vastu Shastra, particularly from the south. Vastu texts have elaborated, depending on the text, generally three styles: Nagara, Dravida, and Vesara. We'll also be seeing Kalinga later, as Shefali ji said. All of these styles are built on very common principles. There is a variation in style, of course. So we will explore the Dravida style, and specifically, we'll explore it through the temples of the two kingdoms, Pallavas and Chalukyas, who were instrumental in establishing these styles across the south. You can see what K.R. Srinivasan, former deputy director of ASI and a renowned archaeologist and historian, has noted about the influence of these kingdoms, their temples, on the subsequent kingdoms which constructed temples. The Agama Shastras deal very holistically with temple architecture and rituals. The deity, the architecture and rituals are not really distinct from one another in the Agamas. The deity dictates the architecture of the shrine, since the temple is as much an extension of the deity as the Vigraha itself. And I think Dr. Deglurkar covered this extensively in the last part of his talk. The shrine too, therefore, has to be very precise for the deity to be effective within. You can't just build a temple and then decide which deity to install. The ideal temple would have at least one entrance, the Gopuram, an Ardha Mandapa, a Mandapa, a Garbhagriha, Shikhara, directly above the Garbhagriha. And the design generally comprises of Gopuram, the entrance. Early South Indian temples don't have a very huge Gopuram that you see these days. In fact, the tallest Gopuram that you'll see is the Srirangam temple, and that was constructed sometime around 1980s. So it is not really a common feature in the earlier temples in terms of having a huge Gopuram. But there is a Gopuram, there is a Dvajastambha. Usually you also have a Balipitha, which is a kind of a lotus pedestal structure for offerings. Then you have a large Mandapa. Then the passageway through the Mandapa, which leads to the Garbhagriha. There is also generally an Ardha Mandapa just after the main Mandapa and before the Garbhagriha. The Garbhagriha with the Vimana above. And you also have Pradakshina Pathas around the Garbhagriha and the Mandapa. These temples also have temple tanks generally. A very important component of temple construction is mandala. Mandalas channel the energy into the temple to make it conducive for the divinity to be installed and thereby fulfill their purpose. In fact, Stella Kramrisch has noted very nicely about Vastu Purusha Mandala. She says, Vastu Purusha Mandala represents the manifest form of the cosmic being upon which the temple is built and in whom the temple rests. The temple is situated in him, comes from him, and is a manifestation of him. The Vastu Purusha Mandala is both the body of the cosmic being and a bodily device by which those who have the requisite knowledge attain the best results. So the Purusha is, of course, not related purely to the ground plan. The Purusha is also related to the elevation of the temple. And Dr. Deglurkar has already covered it by saying how the body and the temple structure itself are completely interrelated. Different parts of the temples are named after the limbs of the body, with prana finally being installed in the murti. From both these talks, keep these elements in mind as we go through pictures of the temples. Now we'll move forward to something more visual, the Pallava temples. So the Pallavas ruled their territory, which was called Tondai Mandalam. Tondai is basically ivy gold. And there are backstories behind it about how the first Pallava floated onto the shores with a Tondai creeper around his neck. They ruled for 6 centuries, late 3rd century till the 9th century. In fact, Vishnu Gopa of Kanchi is mentioned in the Allahabad pillar of Samudragupta, albeit that Samudragupta defeated him in battle. Both Kanchipuram, the capital of the Pallavas, and the renowned seaport of Mahabalipuram, whose temples we'll see, are mentioned in the Sangam literature and also in the works of a lot of European Chinese travelers. We are going to cover in this the temples that were built from the reign of Mahendra Varma Pallava all the way up to Nandi Varma Pallava. Before I go to the temples themselves, I want to share what Kalki has portrayed in his magnum opus, Ponniyin Selvan. He captures a very poignant conversation between a very despondent Parthibendra Pallava and Aditya Karikalan about the ephemeral nature of dynasties and kingdoms and yet what makes them remain in the memory of people even after several centuries of their decline. And the Pallavas indeed have left an indelible mark. As Aditya Karikalan notes, that the architectural masterpieces that Mahendra and Mamallar created will remind people of their greatness for thousands of years. So until the Pallavas arrived on the scene in South India, temples were made of perishable materials such as brick, timber, metal. Mahendra Varman, he also called himself Vichitra Chitta, the curious minded, started using hard rock as the fundamental building block of temples. thereby giving these monuments a very lasting durability. He built the Trimurti temple at Mandagapattu, which is about 20 kilometers away from Jinji or Senji, in which he has inscribed, he proudly declares through an inscription that perishable materials such as brick, metal, mortar, and timber are discarded in favor of living rock. And I must point out, the Pallavas dealt with really hard rock, perhaps the hardest rock compared to all the other several kingdoms. So it was not easy at all. You will notice that there are no major architectural elements here. It has really thud pillars. You see mandapa, and behind there are three sanctums. All three sanctums are today empty. It is administered by ASI. When you visit it, you won't find a single soul around. In fact, right next to it, I think there is a Murugan temple and a small settlement. And it is unfortunately poorly maintained. And that is a shame, considering this is the oldest stone temple in Tamil Nadu. On the way from Jinji to Chennai, you can also stop at Mamandur and Dalavanur, where there are some fine examples of more Pallava rock cut temples. They are also far more detailed than this. Now we will move to Mahabalipuram. Mahabalipuram was indeed an incubation center, because you will very clearly see progression here. The rock cut temples become way more refined. Several structural elements begin to appear. Then monolithic rathas come into existence, thereby forming the first full freestanding structural stone monuments. And finally, you have, of course, the Shore Temple, which is a complete structural temple in itself. Tirumangai Alvar has weaved a wonderful tableau of a rich seaport of his times, and he was a contemporary of Nandivarma Pallava, of a very devout populace that flourished both economically and spiritually under the administration of the Pallavas. Most of the monuments existing today were built during the 7th century, during the reign of Mamalla Narasimhavarman I, and to some extent Parameshwaravarman I. The Shore Temple, of course, was built during the reign of Rajasimha Pallava in early part of the next century. I'll start with the cave temples. I'm going to take you through one example only today in the interest of time, but there are many more cave temples in Mahabalipuram. The Varaha Mandapam cave temple is excavated inside a very large boulder. As soon as you go, you see two typical Pallava lion pillars, two lion pilasters at the end, and also an Artha Mandapa. The shrine today is empty. It is a Vishnu temple. In the roof, you can see many of the architectural elements that Dr. Deglurkar spoke about, the kuta, the salas beginning to appear. The kudu structures have come in. The pillars are far more ornate. The cave temple really now has moved on to version 2.0. The Pallavas sculpted some amazing reliefs on the walls of their temples. There are four such reliefs in this temple: Varaha, Trivikrama, Gajalakshmi, and Durga. It is likely that this was constructed post a victory, because all these deities represent and are symbolic of victory. Varaha relief here is carved exactly in line with Vaikhanasagama. You can notice how seamlessly the neck of the boar merges with the human body. Bhudevi is seated very shy and demure as the Lord brings her out from the depths. Trivikrama is equally imposing. You can also see Jambavan flying right next to Trivikrama. Why is there a Jambavan and Trivikrama depiction? I'm not going to go into the details. I'll leave something for mystery. I recommend you Google its significance and find out on why you see Jambavan in a Trivikrama relief. Next, we see Gajalakshmi and Durga. In the Durga relief, you'll see two deities. One is worshipping her just as any of us would do. The other is actually offering his head to her as a sacrifice. He has a sword ready to cut off his head. These reliefs that you see will reach their peak in the next one that I'm going to show you, which is Arjuna's penance, or the descent of Ganga. This is a very prominent landmark in Mahabalipuram, breathtaking and alluring. The sublime depiction of two different tales, Arjuna getting the Pashupata and Ganga descending to the earth in a single instance, is very clever. You can see many gods, celestial beings like Ganas, Kinnaras, Kimpurushas, Gandharvas, Nagas, etc. on the relief. They have made use of brilliant use of that natural cleft between the two boulders to make it seem as if Ganga is indeed descending from heaven as that cleft. There are many nuances to this relief. In fact, one such nuance is the Pallava clock, which Mahapariva has noted. You can Google to realize how perfectly the exact time of the day, the season, the transition of the sun and the lunar cycle are captured in this relief. We'll now move to the freestanding structures. So we've moved from rock cut temples. Now we will go to the first freestanding structures that we see, the Pancharathas. The Pancharathas were built largely in the reign of Mamalla, Narasimhavarman I. They're all monoliths. You will rarely come across such a variety on display in such a small complex. From a small thatched roof temple to a multi-tiered sikara, the complex really weaves a wonderful milieu of the Dravida style. The complex is dedicated to the Pandavas and Draupadi. There are 5 shrines. They're all chariot styled. And they progress in complexity. The Draupadi Ratha is like a thatched hut. It has a Durga inside on the back panel of the sanctum, very similar to the Durga we saw a few minutes back. Arjuna Ratha is a very smaller temple. Bhima Ratha is imposing and it's almost like a wagon. To the right of it, you have Nakula Sahadeva Ratha. And just next to it is an elephant. This is to indicate that the Vimana itself is shaped like the back of that elephant, Gajaprushthakara. If you noticed carefully, Dr. Deglurkar also mentioned the Gajaprushthakara Vimana in his talk. Of course, the largest and most imposing among these Rathas is the Dharmaraja Ratha. Pallava architects have really displayed some spectacular craftsmanship in this. K.R. Srinivasan says this must be by far the handsomest and most powerful shikara in the range of Dravidian architecture. He goes on to say it gives a sense of architectural transcendence that goes well beyond its formal origins. It's actually 3-tiered. Unfortunately, we can't go to the above tiers because there is no mechanism to go there. It is supposed to have a range of Shaiva iconography on its walls, particularly on the above tiers. We spoke about the mandalas. So you have to note the perfect mandala structure here in the Dharmaraja Ratha, particularly the bottom left one. It is almost a textbook representation. So now we have seen rock cut temples, we've seen freestanding temples. Now we'll move to the complete structural temple that is there in Mahabalipuram. This is the Shore Temple. I would all recommend you, if you know, whenever we get out of this lockdown, etc., and if you go there at dawn, the temple complex opens at 6 a.m., you can get some amazing views of the sunrise right behind the temple. It was built during the reign of Rajasimha Pallava. It consists actually of 3 distinct shrines. The smaller front one that you see is Rajasimha Pallaveshwara. The one behind is Kshatriya Simha Pallaveshwara, the larger one. And finally, between the two, there is a smaller sanctum with Ananta Sai Vishnu, also known as Pallikonda Aruliya Devar. You can see another Varaha on the bottom of the pic, getting ready to dive into the ocean. There is also a small shrine right next to it. On the other side, you will find the lion shrine. In the cavity where the heart of the lion should be, there is a small relief of Mahishasura Mardini. Every structural element that you saw in all the theory that we saw behind is now fully expressed in stone. The progression that is seen in Mahabalipuram will now obviously lead us to Kanjipuram. In Kanjipuram, we'll explore 2 temples where the concepts now begin to enter the metaphysical beyond just the structural. Kailasana, the temple of Rajasimha Pallaveshwaram, as it was called when it was built, it has inspired several kingdoms in their endeavors to build temples. This is like a landmark temple. Rajasimha Pallava, who constructed it, has several inscriptions in the temple and he has expressed its magnificence in his own words. He starts with Harasya Harahasa Rupam Atimanam Atyadbhutam, the bewitching smile of Shiva, proud, most extraordinary. Indeed, in every sculpture that you see in this temple, Shiva is always shown divinely joyous and with the most enticing smile. About the temple structure, Rajasimha says, Shaile Kailasha Leelam Apaharati. The temple has abducted the divine play of Kailasa itself. In every sense, he's accurate. Every possible form of Shiva and his leelas are captured in sandstone. Vimana itself towers like Mount Kailasa. Every attendant gana depicted is absolutely in his or her element, playing, dancing, rejoicing, as one would actually imagine Kailasa to be when Lord sits on it and pervades the universe. Finally, Rajasimha closes it with Shri Rajasimha Pallaveshware, Nagendra Bhoga Bhima Bhushana, Deva Surendra Vrinda Vandita, Sthane Sthitostu Shankaras Chiram. In Rajasimha Pallaveshwaram, bedecked with serpents, worshipped by Indra and Devas, Shankara forever reside in this place. Let's take a look at the structure of the temple. There are approximately 60 small shrines that form a garland around the main. You can see this. These are the smaller shrines. There are approximately 60 of them. And they form like a garland around the main shrine. You also have 10 sub-shrines here attached to the main structure of the building. In these 60 smaller shrines that you see, south side have Samhara Murti forms of Shiva and the north side have Anugraha Murti forms of Shiva. There are murals within them of a richness that will be that almost rivals with Ajanta. Sculptures on the walls of the main temple and smaller shrines are guaranteed to awe the devotee every single time he visits the temple, and you will keep on visiting it. It is such an alluring temple. Scholars believe that the entire temple was probably painted when it was originally built. Outside the Gopuram, you see another 8 shrines. These were built by Rangapataka, Rajasimha's queen. I'll quickly run you through a few pictures. These are the shrines built by Rangapataka. Cholas had their Nataraja, but Pallavas have this form of dancing Shiva as their icon. You'll find it in more than one temple. Some consider it Tandaveshwara, Sandhya Tandava. C. Meenakshi actually identified the pose as the Kunchita pose from Natya Shastra, including the exact verse. Here you can see all the different things that I was talking about. At the bottom, you'll see the Ganas dancing. You see right next to the Lord, Ganas playing music for him to dance, Parvati leaning and looking at him. Keep an eye on the Makara Torana. The Torana has become very elaborate and exquisite, as you can see, straddled by the Pallava lions on the pillars. We have Lingodbhava with Vishnu and Brahma flanking the Lord. Again, the Makara Torana, very elaborate. You have Dakshinamurti. Dakshinamurti is flanked by several creatures. You can see monkeys, birds, and really happy lions for some reason, but and deer beneath his feet. Again, all of the images you will see Shiva with a very enticing smile. You will not come across a Bhikshatana like this. There is so much swag in this image. The Rishi Patnis are at his feet. The Rishis are angry. And, you know, he's walking along very nonchalantly. You will see Urdhva Tandava, where the Lord raises his foot, where he actually lifts his earring, which has fallen on the floor, raises it and reattaches it to his ear. You'll see Nandi right beside him in Chatushta Tandava. Again, being looked upon by Vishnu and Brahma. Then we have Kirata and Arjuna. Kirata Arjuniyam was written by Bharavi, who was a contemporary of the Pallavas. Then you also see Narasimha. You can see the movement depicted really sublimely. So now that we have moved to a Vishnu structure, let's move from Kailasha to Vaikuntha. I'll try and close this quickly. Vaikuntha Perumal temple, if ever there was a temple that stood word for the elements of temple construction, where the body of the temple itself is the Lord within, then that is Vaikuntha Perumal. It was built by Pallava Malla Nandivarma Pallava. It was originally called Parameshwara Vinnagaram or Parameshwara Vishnugriham. The structure of the temple is shown here. The gray area is later construction. We'll explore the black portion. As one enters the main structure, one can see a circumambulatory passage running around the temple. Walls of this passage have panels containing the complete history of Pallavas, starting from the first Pallava. C. Meenakshi has painstakingly chronicled each panel in her thesis. The historical sculptures of Vaikuntha Perumal Temple, Kanchi, which was published in 1941. Then you have a moat-like structure, which when filled with water will represent Kshirasagara, on which the temple, which is the body of God himself, floats. Through the mandapa, one then moves into a sanctum, which is a magnificent seated Vasudeva. Here you see the complete mandala formation, getting expressed both on the ground plan and vertical structure. It is a four-tier temple. As we move from one tier to the next, we are moving from the gross body of the Lord to the causal body, to the subtle body, to Atman. That is Kula Sharira to Sukshma Sharira to Karana Sharira to Atman. At the gross body level, we have Vasudeva. Subtle body level, we see Anantasai Vishnu. In the causal body level, we have a standing Vishnu. The Atman chamber is void. The outer wall of the gross body has depictions of all the continents or physical realms described in the Bhagavata Purana. You'll see Bhadrashva region, Bharata region, Hari region, etc. Gross body, therefore, physical universe. In the first tier, subtle body, you have events of all the Avatara Purushas etched on it. Events from Krishna's life, Rama taking on the ocean, Gajendra Moksha, churning of the ocean, etc. are depicted. Further, Dr. Deglurkar also mentioned Pancharatra philosophy. As per Pancharatra philosophy, the world is manifested by the Lord through Vyuha formations, Sankarshana, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. They are also depicted on the inner corridor as you move up to the first layer. Unfortunately, third and fourth layer are inaccessible today because the temple is in a very dilapidated condition. I'll just quickly run you through some of the views of the temple. Vimana is a towering Meru Vimana, the circumambulatory passage behind which you can see the history panels. The origin of the Pallavas. Pallavas believe themselves to have descended from Ashwatthama. So how does Ashwatthama come? His entire lineage is shown. Then the birth of the first Pallava, where Ashwatthama doing a penance is enticed by Madani and Apsara, and the first Pallava is born. You have events from all the kings before, coronation scenes, war scenes. You can see Ashwamedha Yagna, where the horse is tied to a yupa. You even have adverse depictions. A blank panel to show turmoil in the kingdom after Vishnugopa was defeated by Samudragupta. These two, I will just leave you with the text below for 2 seconds. You can Google and figure out about this. This is a very interesting feature of the Pallava dynasty. Nandivarma Pallava is actually from a collateral lineage. One can go on and on about this temple. I'll stop right now. I just want to leave you with this thought. We saw a lot of vibrant joy in Mahabalipuram temples. We saw Kailasa being brought all the way from Himalayas to Kanjipuram. Then we saw a complex philosophical concept in the physical form in such a way that the form itself became the divine. I think the Pallavas have done it all. They were storytellers, sculptors, architects. Above all, they were really pioneers. With this, I'll give it to Guri to take you through the Chalukyas.
Thank you, Bharat. That was really, really interesting.
Yeah. So, Shefali, I'll share my screen now.
Yeah, please do so. And Guri, just keep track of time, okay?
Yeah, sure. Okay, thank you, Shefali ji. So I'm really glad to be speaking here today among such distinguished people. I'll be presenting in the next few minutes about the Badami Chalukyas and various temple constructions that they made within the 6th to the 8th century. We'll mainly be exploring the sculptural panels as well as briefly the architectural components and their contribution to the craft of temple building. I'd like to begin with this quote by Bhartrihari, where he refers to Shiva as someone who is not definable, yet someone who is pure intelligence and can only be understood through self-perception. Now, this has always been the underlying, what you would say, worldview, Hindu worldview, and this is the basis on which the temples also have been built, wherein the inner Garbhagriha shows the pure essence or the akar roop of that pure essence, and the outer temple construction, equally important, embodies the outer kosha. And it is through understanding this duality can a devotee move to a non-dual state or a moksha. So before moving ahead, just a brief on the Chalukyas of Badami. They existed from the 6th to the 8th century. And they were initially Vaishnavas. They called themselves as Mahabhagavatas, Parambhagavatas, Rana Vikrantas, etc. And in, towards the latter half of their reign, they moved to being Shaivas, focused on the Shaiva Sampradaya. However, during the entire reign, we see them patronizing Shaiva, Vaishnava and Jaina temples equally. They were one of the most powerful kingdoms in that time, and they actually had frequent altercations with the Pallavas in the south, and they also defeated Harsha in the north. So they were a political power that actually even had foreign relations with Iran and Southeast Asia. And one of the most important contributions was defeating the Arab invaders in the first half of the 8th century near Gujarat, Navsari today. If that would have not been done, the invasions would have entered the Deccan earlier than what happened, and we would have not been able to see the kind of temple architecture that exists today. The city of Badami, as you can see today, is expanding around its ancient nucleus from where even the Chalukyas began their political career. This was also a well-known city in ancient times. It was a Tirthasthala associated with Rishi Agastya. The Badami cave temples really deserve a special mention, because they are the next step in the building of cave temples, especially Hindu cave temples. The most initial phase happens in the Ajanta Buddhist temples, and then we see the first Hindu cave temple, at least that is known to us, which is the Elephanta cave temple, and this is the next step. So we see a lot of borrowing of the concepts from those cave excavations in these caves, but we also see a new creation of a new architectural template as well as a new sculptural style. The structures are very simple in terms of architecture. We have an Ardha Mandapa or a porch, followed by the Sabha Mandapa and then the Garbhagriha. So here we'll be looking at the three Hindu cave temples. The Shaiva cave temple here is actually a latter construction, and it is simple in structure. And in fact, if we were to look at the pillars of the cave temple, we would be seeing similarities with the Elephanta caves, where the similar cushioned capital is seen on the fluted column. The porch becomes a subject of some very beautiful panel sculptures. Like, for instance, here we have the depiction of the composite deity of Harihara along with Devi Lakshmi and Devi Parvati. But the most alluring sculpture that exists outside this cave is this 18-armed bas relief of Nataraja, where Shiva seems to be performing an Ananda Tandava, and he's accompanied by Ganesha. This is one of the most beautiful descriptions of this iconography, and the sculptor or the artist has actually rendered motion in a static space. And even though multiple attempts are made after this in the later cave excavations that happen at Ellora, we do not see the similar level of aesthetic. So this is one of the most important sculptures here. Now we'll take a brief look at the Vaishnava cave temples. Now the Vaishnava cave temples are a lot more embellished than the Shaiva that we just saw. And however, they're still unique in the sense that even though we do have contemporary cave temple excavations happening with the Pallavas deep south, they have their own stylistic template of sculpture as well as decorational motifs, which are very unique to the Deccan region. So here you can see a panel of three Vikrama. And one of the most beautiful descriptions here is of this Adi Varaha, iconography of the Varaha Avatar, where he's rescuing Devi Prithvi from the ocean. We saw how Bharat showed another stylistic representation of the same iconography in the Pallava caves. But this is unique in that sense that different elements are used here. The last cave that's present, Hindu cave present here, is literally an epoch in the sense that it introduces new architectural components, which then get replicated later by the Rashtrakutas at Ellora. And also it introduces a level of intricacy that is not seen here before. One of the most visual panels that will strike you when you walk towards the cave is this magnificent Vajantik Virata Rupa of Vishnu, where he's encompassing the three lokas by enlarging himself, and This is in response to a boon that he got from King Bali. Now here we can see that he's Ashtabhuja, holding numerous weapons, and the sculptor has actually used a technique of, say, for instance, showing the Devas above his head, straining against the borders of the Devaloka as a way of showing his expanding form. So there are some beautiful techniques used over here. Now in this cave, we get an inscription by the Chalukyan king, Mangalesha, who mentions that he inaugurated this cave in 578 CE. It's an inscription in Sanskrit. And his intention is very clear. He excavates this cave to create an unparalleled abode for Sri Hari. And therefore we see the amount of work that is put into making this cave. He also dedicates a village and its tax income towards the maintenance of this cave. So, and also he writes in the inscription that visitors, mendicants, and scholars who are visiting the cave should also be provided for. The architectural component that is additionally new in this cave is this bracket-like structure that connects the ceiling to the pillars, which becomes the subject for some very beautiful depictions of Mithuna couples and beautifully bedecked apsaras. And this is an instance of how Shringara Rasa is used to enhance the aesthetic of the cave and also to elevate the mind of the observer. The Vaikunthanath sculpture in this cave can also be observed. So this is one of the most iconic representations where we see Sri Hari in a sitting posture on Anantanag, and he's holding the chakra and the conch. Badami is very well identified by the sculpture. And of course, the ceiling itself is literally like a canvas where we have multiple episodes from the Puranas, Krishna Leela, etc. Literally even on the lintels and on the columns. This is a small example where we can see Brahma surrounded by the Dikpalas. A very unique representation of a Saumya Narasimha, where Narasimha Bhagwan is in a very, very good mood. He seems to be leaning on a mace, which is currently not present. But here the iconography is slightly different because instead of holding a chakra and a conch, which we see in every representation of the Vishnu avatar, he holds dwarves instead, or ganas. So these could be the other possibly icons of the same symbols. And we see a Garuda in the human form instead of the normal iconography. So a new attempt being made here. We'll now move to the main site where the Chalukyas of Badami actually constructed most of their temples. And the Chalukyas deserve a mention because they are the singular dynasty that patronized both architectural styles, the Dravida as well as the Nagara style. So the Deccan literally became a meeting point for both these styles. And also at Aihole, they literally undertook a lot of experimentation in constructing multi-tiered Garbhagriha temples, as well as the apsidal form of a temple in the Durga temple that you would see at Aihole. So there was a lot of experimentation happening in the Deccan, and it was being spearheaded by the Chalukyas. So Pattadakallu becomes literally like the crucible on which and the experimentation theater wherein we see all kinds of temple structures. So we'll be exploring them in the next few slides. Before moving ahead, just a brief look at how the Nagara Prasada architecture especially progressed, because Bharat has already covered the aspects of the Dravida architecture. So the Guptas were the first pioneers, and from the 3rd century onwards, we see an attempt to use hard rock instead of brick or wood structures to create temples. The cave temples also that we saw earlier would have replicated some of the motifs as well as the ceiling panels or the pillars that were used in these wood construction. So we see probably a movement of the same as the material changes. So we can probably use that to guess how the previous structures look like. But the first Gupta temple at Sanchi that we know of is a very simple structure, flat roof. Then we move on to this Parvati temple where a platform is added and a circumambulatory path is provided. The next stage then moves on to this brick temple at Bhitargaon where we have a stepped pyramidal kind of structure, literally which was used by the Dravidian sthapatis. This is not the curvilinear Nagara Shikhara, but this temple, which is the most important template or the first Nagara Prasada style, you can call it, Dashavatar temple at Deogarh, which literally has the remains of a triangular shikhara and has its own viewing mandapas on three sides with sculptures of Vishnu. So this was a very important development. And after this, we then see the next stage of development happening in the Deccan, where again the Chalukyas play an extremely important role. So the shikhara is the curvilinear structure that is very, very much delineates it from the Dravida style. It is divided into horizontal sections called bhumis and vertical sections called latas. And using different combinations of these, as well as multiple repetition of shikharas in the form of a cluster of shikharas like we saw at the Khajuraho temple, you can create variations. It also, a Nagara temple also consists of the same similar structure in terms of mandapas. It will have the porch, the sabha mandapa, the antaral, and then finally the garbhagriha. So the earlier temples that were built here were of this typical style. However, they were not very, very grandiose in the scale. And if we were to look at one of the earlier temples, the most pronounced is this Mukhapatti, which actually gives you a carving of what is enshrined or what is a deity enshrined in the temple. So since this is a Shiva temple, we are seeing Nataraja here. We also see a very unique kind of iconography here, wherein we see five Shivalingas atop the roof, which probably stand for the five Shiva Tattvas, something that we do not really see frequently in Nagara temples. Now, the Galagna temple is where the template of the Nagara Prasada style of temple gets fully formalized. The shikhara increases in size. There is a lot more intricate work done on it. And you can see the finial here, the typical Amalaka and the Kalasha on top. Now, this is an exact copy of the Arka Brahma temple that exists at Alampur today. Both were built by the Chalukyas of Badami. There is also circumambulatory paths in this temple now. And there are sculptures with viewing mandapas on the side, similar to the Dashavatar temple that we just saw. Only one survives today, which portrays the Andhakasur Vadh episode. We finally now move to the Dravida section of the constructions that happened at Pattadakallu. And even though the Chalukyas actually built some experimentation of their idea of the Karnataka style of template at Badami in terms of the Malagitti Shivalaya. And if you were to look at Mahakuta, the temple at Mahakuta, those were the initial attempts at creating octagonal shikharas as well as creating a tiered layer as the Vimana. But this is where it gets actually formalized again. So this is this temple itself, it may not seem very ornate, but in terms of its value add to the evolutionary curve, it cannot be ignored. So here we see the introduction of this hara or the parapet component, where above the main primary structure, we see the use of these shalas and the kuta structures, which are also seen on Pallava temples, and the tiered pyramidal sort of vimana. Now, each layer here is a copy of the base. It's an exact copy of the base in terms of proportion and even style. It is just built in a reducing size. The components, as you can see, Sabha Mandapa, Adha Mandapa, and the two tiers of this temple. So, just a brief look at the inscription that we see here. It gives us an insight into how the decisions were made regarding temple building. So we have an inscription outside this temple, which says that even though this is of a later period, it documents how the temple was built, wherein 52 members of Abhimanapura, which is a local village, they took the decision on selecting the Sthapati. So even though the patronage was done by the king, the local decisions were taken by the council of wise men or what you would call today as a panchayat, or probably it was decentralized, wherein the relevant parties made the decision. It was not like a despotic sort of a line of power. We also find various inscriptions where people make donations. And this is for centuries after the Chalukyas have been defeated. People kept the temples at this site running and, alive.
Guri, yeah. Just keep a track of the time, please.
Sure. Yeah. I'll just need, maybe I'll go a little faster. I'll just take around 5 more minutes. the Virupaksha temple is the final culmination in this series, wherein it actually is the zenith of Chalukyan sculpture. We see a lot more of development here in terms of the sculptural panels as well as the intricacy. And the story behind this is that Vikramaditya Chalukya invades Kanchi. He sees the Kailasanathar or the Raj Simha Pallaveshwara temple, and he's so enamored that he actually dedicates a huge amount of gold to the temple, comes back and resolves to build a temple unparalleled. And that's how the Virupaksha temple came into existence. Now, the Virupaksha temple has one separate architectural feature, like the addition of a Sukhanasi here, which is a copy of the Mukhapatti that we see on the Nagara temples, which does not exist in any contemporary Dravidian architecture. Now, we see many beautiful sculptures like those of Mithunas as well as ceiling work in this temple, which is not, the richness of which is not unparalleled within that contemporary time. We also get an inscription about who made the temple. It was an architect called Gundan Anivarikachari who made the temple, and he's exempt from paying taxes for the rest of his life. So he's rewarded not just by money, but by also such measures. Before we move ahead, we'll just take a look at a beautiful Mahishasur Mardini sculpture, a very different kind of a sculpture, not seen before in the cave temple excavation. Now, this is present in a sub-shrine within the main temple. The Mallikarjuna temple that lies right next to the Virupaksha temple is just a smaller copy. And this is the beautiful Nandi Mandapa that we're looking at with the Gajathara and also the use of Apsaras for decoration. The Sabha Mandapa of the temples inside have pillars with a lot of intricate work done here. We see many inscriptions here which tell us that schools flourished, which worked with the Shastras like the Natya Shastra. There would have been schools of musicians, there would have been various guilds who were providing artisans who would work on sculpture. So it was a vibrant place that we cannot really imagine how it would have looked today. But we would have had various exponents of Shastras as well as Shastra art happening in the surroundings of this temple. The last Nagara temple built here is the Kashi Vishveshwara temple. One needs to recognize it for the intricacy of work within the temple in terms of pillars of the Sabha Mandapa as well as the ceiling work. The pillars themselves are a development in the Nagara architecture, where we see the use of Kirti Mukha and the Gaja capital, and also scenes from Kailasha. Like for instance here, this is Ravana lifting Kailasha. Just quickly, last few slides, looking at the sculptures present on the outer facade of the temple. These sculptures on the outer facade also play a very important role, wherein they help the devotee to leave behind or to get detached from the temporal realities and ready his or her mind to go before the ultimate darshan of the deity. So here we can see one of the descriptions outside, which is of Harihara. And here we have an Ashtabuja Vishnu, even though this is a Shaiva temple, a beautiful Makara Torana with a Shiva Parvati. And below we have Mahishasur Mardini. Every panel has been done with a lot more detailing than we would have seen previously. This is Uma Maheshwara on the left. And on the right, we see a scene from the Ramayana where Devi Sita is being abducted by Ravana. Just finally, before I close, a look at one or two miniature sculptures which are present on the inner walls of the temple. So the inner walls of the temple are a knowledge body, literally, in terms of episodes from the Puranas, from the Itihasa, as well as it gives us a window into the life of the nobility, how the palace environments probably were. For instance, the first panel shows Bhishma lying on his bed of arrows with the Pandavas paying obeisance to him. On the right, you can see episode from the Ramayana where we see the Shurpanakha getting her nose cut and then finally resulting in the abduction of Devi Sita. On the left, you can see a noble woman, a Chalukyan nobility or probably a princess, how she would have been feted in those days, where she's surrounded by attendants and even is facing a scribe who probably takes orders from her or writes letters for her. On the right, we see this beautiful, sculpture depicting the Kirat Arjuna episode from the Mahabharata. And above is a very interesting sculpture where a single step from the from probably the Natyashastra has been encoded step by step as from position A to position C. So a very interesting way of depicting that. So finally, I'll close with this collage of some of the themes that we have explored and also some which we were unable to explore, like the Durga temple at Aihole, as well as the multi-storied temple, which were the most initial experimentations. The Chalukyas would have to be credited for creating a very diverse range of structures, for patronizing all sects or sampradayas, and literally creating the golden age for the Nagara as well as the Dravida template, which then went on to influence even the construction of the Kailashnath temple at Ellora.
I just want to thank Bharat and Gurpreet for the presentation. For all the viewers, I'd like to inform you that that Indic Academy is publishing a coffee table book based on the research done by Gurpreet and Bharat. Will be published in a month's time or so. The limited point is that they're all, Gurpreet is a merchant banker in Mumbai. Bharat is working for an engineering company in Chennai. But they're very passionate and they are resulting in a book. Actually, this book has been very coincidentally made possible by Dimple, who saw them exchanging photographs. And then she said, why don't you convert your passion into a book? So now finally, we're going to have a coffee table book published. So please do buy the book and encourage them to produce and write more such books.
Like Sardesai says, buy my book to know.
Hello.
Thank you, Shafali. Thank you, Bharat. Thank you. Yeah.